patients, the power of no signaling proof. The main result is a cryptographic result about classical delegation of computation. I will tell you what it is about. But it also has some quantum part, or at least something that is might be interesting for the quantum community, is that on the way to the proof, we determine exactly the power of multiprover interactive proofs with no signaling, with no signaling provers, with no signaling strategies. And I will tell you about that too. And this is a joint work with Yael Taumann-Kalai from Microsoft Research and Ron Rothblum from Weizmann Institute. So let me start from the problem of computation, of delegation of computation, verifiable delegation of computation. So what is delegation of computation? It's all classical, nothing quantum is here. Alice has an input X, and she really needs to compute some function f of x, where the best in this talk to think of f as a polynomially computable function. Although everything that I'm going to say scale up to x, and I will actually talk about it, but just for now think about it as a polynomially computable function that is publicly known. Alice really wants to compute f of x, but she only has a weak device, and she doesn't have enough computational power to do that. But luckily enough, Bob offers to compute f of x for Alice. So Alice sends x to Bob. Bob sends back f of x to Alice, and everybody is happy. So this situation occurs today many times. Alice can be just a computer that delegates the computation to the cloud. Today, there are very cloud platform services that offer to do all your computations, and some companies don't even have strong computers. They just have weak computers that delegate all the computation to the cloud. Or it can be some weak device like a cell phone that wants to delegate computation. So there are many applications, and this actually happens today a lot. I think most of the previous papers on the subject missed the real application of delegation of computation, is that Alice wants to delegate computation when she runs out of battery, if she forgot to charge her cell phone, to avoid further frustration. So what if Alice doesn't trust Bob? Bob might be malicious, Bob might have viruses in his computer, or maybe just as bugs in his computer. Alice wants some guarantee that the computation was performed correctly. And this brings us to the notion of delegation of computation, a delegation scheme for a function f. And here I describe a one-round delegation scheme with computational soundness. And this is the definition. So Alice is the verifier. From now on, she's called the verifier also. And Bob is the prover. So there is some interactive proof going on here. The interactive proof has only one round. In the first round, Alice sends the input X together with some additional information that we think of a challenge or a query, and we call it Q. And Bob answers with the output of the function of f on the input x, so Bob answers with f of x, together with some additional information w that we think of as a proof that the computation was performed correctly. And then based on this, Alice, the verifier, accepts or rejects. So we have the following four requirements from this scheme in order for it to be a one-round delegation scheme. So f now is computable in time t of n. You can think of t of n as polynomial time or up to exponential time, anything in between. Maybe the best for now to think about it as polynomial time, but it's general. So the first two requirements are the standard completeness and soundness requirements that we have from interactive proofs or interactive arguments in this case, because the soundness is computational. So the completeness is that if P is honest, then the probability that V accepts the computation is 1 minus something negligible. Almost always, Alice will accept a computation that was done correctly by an honest prover that gives the proof correctly. The soundness requirement is computational. It's only for a computationally bounded cheating prover, and it says that for any cheating prover that runs in time T star of n, where T star you can think of it as polynomial or quasi-polynomial in T, maybe that's the best, but it's a parameter. For any cheating prover that runs in time T star of n, if the computation was not done correctly, then Alice rejects with very high probability. Nearly always she rejects. So these are the standard requirements of completeness and soundness from interactive proofs or arguments, actually here from interactive arguments, but to this we add two efficiency requirements. And the efficiency requirements are this and this. First, the running time of the prover, we want it to be polynomial in T of n. Bob is just a stronger computer. He's not a magician. A long time ago, there was a rumor that he's a magician called Merlin, but he's not a magician. He's just a stronger computer, and we want Bob to run in polynomial time, in time polynomial of T of n. Also, we want the running time of Alice to be significantly smaller than T of n. We want the computation to be delegated. If Alice worked in time T of n, then she could have done the computation by herself. We want this time, running time of Alice, to be much smaller, and typically we want it to be almost linear time, but surely significantly smaller than the time T of n.
Q
can be anything. We think of it as a challenge that the verifier gives to the prover, as a query that the prover has to answer in order to prove the result.
And are there limits on the size of W?
So the limits are, there is a limit on the verifier.
Well, I mean,
the running time of the verifier should be small. So in general, we think about a verifier that runs in almost linear time. But in the protocols that I will talk about, W will be even smaller than that. You can place a limit on the communication if you want. Okay, so let me tell you about the previous work for this model. The best previous work was by Goldwasser, Kalai, and Guy Rothblum. And they practically solved, this scheme is also should be scaled down for one round by a protocol by Yael Kalai and myself. So the problem was solved when F could be computed by a circuit of small depth. So if F is a log space uniform circuit of size T and depth D, then there is a one-round delegation scheme such that the running time of the prover is polynomial in T, and the running time of the verifier is tilde O of N plus poly D. This hides polylogarithmic factors, so it's basically N plus poly D. The problem with this scheme is that it depends on the depth of the circuit. So it only works for computations that can be done by a circuit with small depth. So this is the main drawback of this protocol. And what we prove in our result, we give an essentially full solution for the problem. We give a delegation scheme for any function that in time T of n. You can think of T of n as polynomial or exponential or anything in between. We give a one-round delegation scheme such that the running time of the prover is polynomial in T of n. the running time of the verifier is n time poly log in t and t star, I would say. So it's actually the running time of the verifier is almost linear. It's linear up to polylogarithmic factors. Actually, the running time of the verifier can even be smaller than that. It's enough that the verifier knows one or few points in the low, what is called the low degree extension of the input. So if the verifier knows that, even this n can be removed. So, but otherwise the n is necessary because the verifier must read the input. So using this delegation scheme, you can delegate computation in one round. Alice only works almost linear time, and she is guaranteed that the computation was done correctly, and the running time of the prover is poly in T of n. All this under exponential hardness assumptions, under, I would say, standard cryptographical assumption. It's a cryptographical protocol because it works with the computational soundness.
What's the model? What's the model of the Turing machine?
What is the model of the linear time algorithm? What's the model? It's a uniform algorithm. So it's a Turing machine.
In fact, it matters if you go that low. Is it one tape,
oh,
two tapes?
You have not
polylogs. Oh, that's right. So, but you have two tapes, right? You must have
all tapes. It's not a problem.
It yeah. Matters, by the way.
You can do it with two tapes if you want. It's just a standard algorithm. So you're asking if I need one tape or two tape? I don't even know, but let's say two tape. Sorry, I didn't count the number of tapes. let me tell you about variant of delegation schemes. Actually, the important thing is I described a one-round delegation scheme with computational soundness. And these are two things that could be changed. You could consider one-round or interactive scheme, and you could consider computational or statistical soundness. And we consider one-round scheme in the computational case, one-round because it's ultimate, it's better than interactive, and computational because usually in cryptography, people don't really care if the soundness is computational or not, and also because it's necessary for one round. But there are many other results about all these four models, and there are also other results that I didn't mention under what is called unfalsifiable cryptographic assumptions and with pre-processing. So there are lots of results that I don't really want to describe because I don't have much time. Okay, so what I want to tell you now is about the approach of Aiello et al, which is the starting point of our work. And this approach is based on the multi-prover interactive proof model of Ben-Or, Goldwasser, Killian, and Wigderson. And in this model, we have more than one prover. We have we have many provers, but here it's described only with two provers, but it can be generalized, of course, to many provers. So we have two provers, A and B, who claim that the input X is in some language L. And the proof goes as follows. The verifier V sends a query Q to A and a query R to B. There is no interaction between A and B. Also, for now, not even quantum entanglement between A and B. And A needs to answer by an answer A, which is only a function of Q, and B by an answer B, which is only a function of R. And based on Q, R, A, and B, the verifier decides whether to accept or reject the statement that X is in L. So this is the model, and what is really nice about this model is that there are very strong results that are actually the best that you could hope for, more or less. So it's by Fortnow, Lund, and actually for this you need to do it in one round by Feige and Lovaas. Actually, for all this, you also need the PCP theorem, because I actually require here also efficiencies. But okay, so it's based on many works. So the protocol actually shows that MIP equals non-deterministic exponential time. Here I scale it down and I only write it for languages that can be computed in deterministic time T of n. But it all works also for non-deterministic time. Just for this talk, it's important for me the deterministic time. So let's assume that n can be computed in time T of n, where think again of T of n either as polynomial time or up to exponential. And again, it can even be non-deterministic, but forget about this for now, actually for this talk. So there is a two-provers, multi-prover interactive proof with the following requirement, with the following properties. So first, we have a perfect completeness. So if A and V are honest, then the probability that we accept is 1. We have a soundness almost perfect, 1 minus negligible. So the probability that V rejects if actually X is not in L is almost 1, no matter what the provers A and B do. The running time of both A and B is polynomial in T of N. And the running time of the verifier is tilde O of n, is up to polylogarithmic factors, is linear. And also, if you want, the communication is polylogarithmic in T of n. So it's a really, really good delegation scheme, except that it delegates the computation to two provers rather than one. And you assume here that there is no communication between the two provers, an assumption that in real life, when you delegate computation to the cloud, you cannot really assume. So this is the protocol. And what Aiello et al. Suggested is a way to use cryptography to reduce the number of provers back to one. From two or even more provers, you can reduce the number of provers to one. So this is a suggested protocol. I will describe it. So what Aiello et al. Suggested is to start from a multi-prover interactive proof protocol and to translate it into what is called a one-round argument, one-round protocol with only one prover that is based on computational soundness. So suppose that in the original protocol, V sends Q to A and R to B and gets answer A from A and B to B, from B. So in the modified protocol with only one prover, what V will do, V, the verifier, will use what is called a fully homomorphic encryption and will encrypt Q and R using a fully homomorphic encryption. I'm not going to tell you what exactly, I'm not going to give the definition of a fully homomorphic encryption, but the mechanism of a fully homomorphic encryption allows the prover to compute A and B, although the prover only sees the encryption of Q and R. So this is the suggestion. So P only gets the encryption of Q and the encryption of R, and therefore it seems likely that P cannot use R in order to compute A and cannot use Q in order to compute B. So again, I don't want to get into exactly what is a fully homomorphic encryption. It's not really important for the rest of the talk, but this was the suggestion. Yes?
So here you have to make assumptions that are behind the security of the
feature. That what?
There's some kind of a security assumption that's necessary.
Yes, exactly, exactly. You need to assume that the FAG cannot be broken, is secure.
There was no FAG.
That's true. Back then there was no FAG. They suggested to use peer scheme, cryptographic peer scheme, and everything I'm going to say also works when you use a cryptographic peer scheme.
And I mean, the concept was known a long time, just that no one had a scheme.
But they did have peer scheme back then.
Yeah, but
The concept was known, except I don't know if people believe that, that it actually exists.
For the remainder of the talk, you're going to make this assumption that...
All the cryptographic schemes that we talk about must use some cryptographic assumption because they work... So you have a computational assumption on the prover, that the prover is computationally limited, and in order to use that, you need some cryptographic assumption. So for the cryptographic protocol, we need some cryptographic assumption. We need the existence of a fully homomorphic encryption scheme. But for the talk, we will be able soon enough to forget about that. So this was the suggestion, and the only problem is that no one knows if it works or not. There is no proof that this actually works, and no one could actually give even a general enough case in which this works. And our starting point actually is that if you assume some additional requirement, additional soundness requirement, if you assume that the soundness of the multi-prover interactive proof protocol is stronger than what you had, then you can prove security of the Aiello et al. Suggestion. And this is called no signaling strategies. So we want our protocol, our original multi-prover interactive proof protocol, to be secure to no signaling strategies. And I think maybe in these forums, many people know what are no signaling strategies because they are related to quantum computation, and we will talk about it later. So let me now give you the definition of what is a no signaling strategy. And this is the definition with two provers. We will later on see the definition for a larger number of provers. So suppose that this is our original protocol. We send Q to A, R to B, and A answer by A, B answer by B. Now we think of the provers, of each prover, as a prover that can see both inputs. A can see both Q and R, and B can see both Q and R, and both of them can also see a common random string that they share. And prover A answers by some function of Q, R, and Z. Prover B answers by some function of Q, R, and Z. And they need to satisfy the following requirements that are called the no signaling requirements, one for each prover. The first requirement is that conditioned on the query Q for the first prover, the random variables A and R are independent as random variables. So if we condition on the question of the query that got the first player, the answer of the first player doesn't give any information about the query for the other prover. And vice versa. Condition on the input for the second prover, the answer of the second prover does not give any information about the query for the first prover. So this is the no signaling condition in two provers. Actually, in K provers, this is the condition, the no signaling condition for K provers. For K provers, you require the same for any subset, any two subset of provers. So suppose that we have now K provers that get queries Q1 to QK and give answers A1 to AK. Each AI now is allowed to be a function of all the queries and of a common random string that all the provers share. And the requirement is that for every subset S of queries, if you condition on all the queries to this subset, then the answers of all the provers in this subset gives no information about the queries to all the other provers. So this set of answers is independent of this set of queries as random variables conditioned on this set of queries. So this is the no signaling condition, and soundness against no signaling condition means that for any no signaling strategies, if the input X is not in the language L, then the probability that V rejects is almost one. So the verifier needs to reject not only classical strategies for the K-probers, but also the verifier needs to reject on all no signaling strategies. And this is the stronger assumption, the no signaling assumption, that we need to assume. And if we assume this, we can prove that the scheme of a yellow et al. Does work. So we can prove that any multi-prover interactive proof with no signaling soundness can be translated into one round argument, or in our case, into a delegation scheme using the approach of a yellow et al. Actually, we need soundness for almost no signaling strategies, not only for no signaling strategy, but we need soundness to strategies that are very, very close to no signaling. This is even stronger, but this actually, in all our proofs, when you proof for no signaling, you also see that the proof actually works for almost no signaling also. Anyway, one corollary of what we do is that interactive proofs can be translated to one round argument. This was known by a result of Yael Kalai and myself, but this gives a better understanding. What we do now gives a better of an understanding of that proof. Actually, it gives the right formalism to state that proof. But of course, the real challenge is to see what can, to come up with new multi-prover interactive proofs with no signaling soundness, and to use them to get one round delegation schemes. And that's exactly what we do. And let me tell you now about no signaling strategies. I guess that, yes.
Okay, so how many non-signaling provers do you need in your protocol?
Well, two,
you will see. Okay.
Let me tell you a little bit about no signaling strategies. I'm sure that in this forum many people know about that. No signaling interactions were studied in physics long before multiprover interactive proofs were defined. And this is because all interactions in physics are no signaling. And they were also studied as, in the case of multi-prover interactive proofs, in relation to multi-prover interactive proofs with entangled provers. So I guess by now, all of you know what are multi-prover interactive proofs with entangled strategies. We heard about it. But in general, just to repeat, just to review, we have two provers, A and B, that get classical queries, Q and R, and does answer by classical answers A and B, but the two provers share a common quantum state, and before they answer, each prover can measure his part of the state. So they share quantum entanglement and they use it. So these are, in this case, it's two provers with a shared entangled quantum state. And we say that multi-prover interactive proofs are sound against entangled strategies if for any entangled provers, in this case I talk about K-provers, if X, the input, is not in the language L, then the probability that V rejects is close to one. And we heard, yes, all of you heard yesterday about the breakthrough from 2 years ago by Itu and Vidic, and then also by another paper by Vidic that shows that multi-prover interactive proofs with entangled strategies contains NXP. Actually, I prefer to think about MIP star as classical protocols that are sound against entangled strategies, And then this is exactly next. Actually, until yesterday, it was in my slide. I had equal here, but I didn't want to freak out some people here in the audience, so I changed it. But maybe I will change it back after the talk. I'm talking about classical protocols, so the completeness must be with classical provers, and then there is, and then it's known to be next. So that's what I'm saying. But it's not important. I can leave it in the slide. So what is the relation between entangled provers and no signaling provers? So the relation is that entangled strategies are no signaling, and I think that's the main reason that people studied it. No signaling is an easier mathematical condition, and all entangled strategies are no signaling. And this, of course, can be proved mathematically, but there is a strong physical intuition. And the physical proof, I would say, is that signaling means that information can travel faster than light. Because a signaling strategy means that the information passed instantly from Alice to Bob, if the output of Alice gives information about the input of Bob. So actually, this is from Bob to Alice. But the information passes instantly, which means faster than light, and we know by special relativity that information cannot pass faster than light. And actually, the no-signaling principle stands in a way above quantum computation. The no-signaling principle is likely to hold in any future ultimate theory of physics. Quantum theory is just a theory, and we know that it's not complete, so it's possible, at least, actually I will love to hear your opinion about that, if it's possible, that a future theory of physics will have some what is called super quantum correlations that are not even, cannot be modeled by entangled states, but by no signaling correlations. So if you prove no signaling soundness for your scheme, then this soundness is likely to then your scheme is likely to remain sound even in any future physical theory, and not only in the current quantum theory that we have. So I guess it all depends on your standard of security. So if you want to remain secure in the future, you have to use no signal. Okay, so what do we know about no signaling soundness? What do we know about multiprover interactive proofs with no signaling soundness? Actually, it was studied before us in several works. And it turns out that no-signaling cheating provers are very powerful. So in particular, we know that classical multiprover interactive proofs, or even quantum, even multiprover interactive proofs with entanglement, with soundness against entangled provers, is NEXP. But no-signaling multiprover interactive proofs was known to be between EXP and P-space. And actually, if you only talk about two provers, then it was known to be equal to P-space by a result by Ito, and this is both of these results are by linear programming. In particular, it means that all the all the known protocols that show that multiprover interactive proofs that MIP equals NEXP cannot work do not have no signaling soundness. Yes?
In these equation and inequalities, are you thinking of MIP with classical completeness or with quantum computers? I mean, like
in
the
this
other
one?
Slide.
No quantum, there's no signaling.
In this one?
The definition in the completeness, do you assume like totally classical machines or anything that can be no signaling for the completeness?
Well, completeness of what?
Well, in no signaling MIP. I mean, you have two conditions. You have the completeness, and there the question is which set of provers are allowed there. Any no signaling provers or classical provers?
So let's say that I allow only classical.
Okay.
In our protocol, it will be classical. So let's say that I allow only classical. So anything, the point of what I want to say that is that all known proofs for MIP equals NEXP do not have no signaling soundness. And this must be the case because no signaling MIP is contained in EXP. And all these proofs were for NEXP, or if you want, scaled down to NP. And many times it's really easy to see what is the no signaling strategy that breaks the soundness. And you can see, I gave in this example, for XOR games, where the verifier V sends Q to A, R to B, and gets the answer A and B from A and B. And suppose that the only test that the verifier does is to check that A XOR B is some constant that depends on Q and R. So this is a XOR game, but in this particular case, it's really easy to give no signaling strategy for which the verifier accepts with probability one. And this is the strategy. A answers by VQR XOR Z, where Z is a random bit, and B answers by Z. And then the XOR of both of them is exactly the right value, although each of them is a random bit even when you condition on both inputs. So this is an example. And actually, this example generalized to many other multi-prover interactive proofs. Many times, all you need to do in order to find the no signaling strategy that breaks the scheme is just to let the two provers or to the many provers to give a random assignment that satisfies the verifier. And this works in many cases. It would be, in many cases, a no signaling strategy for which the verifier accepts. So our result is that no signaling multi-prover interactive proofs equals EXP. So actually, as I said, our completeness will be classical, but the soundness will be also against no signaling multi-prover interactive proof. And this is actually the result is more general. For any language in time t of n, we give a multi-prover interactive proof with the following property. The running time of the provers will be polynomial in t of n, so the provers will be efficient. The running time of the verifier will be almost linear, tilde O of n, where tilde O hides polylogarithmic factors, so it's polylogarithmic in t of n, n times polylog t of n. The number of provers is polylogarithmic in t of n. So even if t of n is exp, then it will be a polynomial number of provers. But in particular, if t is polynomial, it will be polylogarithmic number of provers. The communication is polylogarithmic, and the completeness of the protocol is one with classical provers. And the soundness is against no signaling strategies with negligible, and the soundness is with negligible error. Okay, so this is the main result for no signaling. And you can think of this result also as a scheme to delegate computation to a group of provers that can apply any no signaling strategy. And this you can...
Sorry, I'm sorry. I have to insist on the thing that I said before.
Sorry?
So I want to insist on this polylogarithm, on this many tapes. I have a reason for asking. So are these things streaming algorithms? Are these the verifiers, do they read from left to right? Because, for example, if you have two tapes and you read from left to right and you do it just logarithmically many times, then your verifiers...
You can read
then you can reduce it down to a log space Turing.
Yes,
It's much stronger than what you have.
You can read from left to right. You can read from left to right.
Then you have a stronger result there.
The stronger result that we have, at least as far as we understand it, maybe you can tell me later.
We'll talk later.
The stronger result that we have is that the verifier doesn't even need to know the input. I mentioned it before, but the verifier only needs to know one point in the low degree extension, one or if you want a little bit more than one. A point in the low degree extension of the input, which is some error correcting code of the input. So the low degree extension can be computed by streaming. So you can, with one pass on the input, compute this one point. Or if the verifier gets this one point for free, the verifier doesn't need to know anything else. So it doesn't even need to read the input. If you know this point for free, and then the running time of the verifier is only polylogarithmic. Does this answer the question?
The verifier
only needs to know a point or a small number of points in the low degree extension of the input. Okay, so this is the result. You can think of it as delegating computation to a group of no-signaling provers.
Sorry to go on that question. so you want us to think of MIP star as classical provers, but the proofs are secure against quantum entangled provers.
So I'm talking about no signaling.
I know, but you say that this is basically a strengthening of a result that MIP star, according to your definition, equals NX.
Our result?
Yes.
It's incomparable. It shows that with multi-prover interactive proofs with no signaling soundness is exp, not nexp, exp. That's the... So it's only for exp, and it cannot be improved. It's tight.
Doesn't security against no signaling provers imply security against entanglement?
Exactly, yes, but this is only for exp, and the results for entanglement is for nexp, for non-deterministic exponential data.
That
it contains exp, yeah. This is another proof of that, yeah. In particular, yes. Yes, it gives soundness against entangled provers in particular, as a special case.
Okay. Which was that? Sorry, was it
X
known
is
before?
Smaller than MX.
Sorry?
X is smaller than
MX. So is conjecture.
We
yeah,
don't know.
So it was known before.
But only through your result.
Yes. Yes, it wasn't known more than 2 years ago. Yes, in particular, it proves that that you can have a protocol with multi-prover interactive proofs with entangled provers for exp. Sorry, not for nexp. So you can think of it as delegating computation for a group of provers with no signaling that can have no signaling strategies. I think of it as delegating computation to the Martians. The Martians are amazing engineers. They constructed a quantum computer in their prehistory already. They built iPhones in kindergarten. And last week, they announced the new computer. It's called the ExpTime machine. It runs any ExpTime computation in 1 second. And we, on Earth, want to delegate all our computation to the Martians, all our computations to the Martians, but we don't trust them. Also, we don't know. Maybe they have higher physics than ours, so we don't trust that they only have quantum entanglement. And this gives a way to delegate computation to the Martians. You take K-Martians, you put them in different points in space and you ensure that there is no communication between them by just by sending them the queries and expect the answers to arrive a little bit like almost in the speed of light, so they don't have time to communicate between them. They might have no signaling interactions between them, but still you are guaranteed that the proof is correct. So this gives a scheme, as I said, to do that with poly-T number of, the running time of the provers is poly-T, the running time of the verifier is N poly log T, the number of provers is poly log T, it's written twice. And the completeness is one, the soundness is against no signaling strategies. Okay, I won't tell you about the proof, but I will tell you about the first step, which can also be considered as a result. And the result is about what we call no signaling PCPs. So the first step of the proof is to switch from MIP to PCP. The result is about what we call no signaling PCP. And let me tell you what is a no signaling PCP. In a standard PCP, we have a verifier that reads the classical PCP in K places. In what we call no signaling PCP, usually in a standard PCP, a classical PCP, there is some bit written in each of them. In a no signaling PCP, for every subset S of locations, up to some global parameter that we call K, there is a distribution AS. And when the verifier queries these locations, the verifier gets some vector of answers which is distributed according to the distribution AS. And the only guarantee is that for any S1 and S2 that are smaller than the global parameter K, this parameter will be polylog T. So for any two sets that are smaller than the global parameter, the two distributions must agree on their intersection. So this is what we call a no signaling PCP. So when the verifier queries K queries, the verifier gets some answers that are given according to some distribution. It can be different distribution for every set of queries, but they must agree on the intersection as long as both sets are smaller than the global parameter K, than polylog T. Yes? Sorry? To agree on the intersection, yes, the projection. So if you take according to S1 and then you restrict to the intersection, you get the same as if you take according to S2 and restrict to the intersection.
So doesn't that mean, like, for example, the first bit can't somehow the distribution, the marginal distribution of that can't depend on what other bits are queried?
Yes. Yes. Exactly. And what we prove is actually a PCP theory with no signaling soundness is that, but only for deterministic computation, for any L in time T of N, we have a PCP with the following properties. The running time of the prover is polynomial in T, the running time of the person who actually creates the PCP. The running time of the verifier is almost linear. The number of queries is polylogarithmic, and this is also the global parameter K. The completeness is one, and the soundness is against no signaling strategies, as I defined them.
Suppose you, asked a slightly different question, which is, given such local distributions, are they consistent with the global distribution? What's the complexity of that?
Okay, so
that's it. Okay,
so I didn't require that there is a global distribution that they are all consistent with.
Mm-hmm.
and that's the problem.
No, I understand, but
so you're asking if I get the distributions?
Yeah, yeah. So is that a hard problem?
That's just a hard problem. It's enough because you can take the best one and then the particular string that would maximize.
Yes.
Randomly.
Yes, I think so.
So when you do hierarchies of SDPs, you get these
often you get these local
distributions.
Right.
And finding a global distribution is empty.
But here you are sort of you're somehow making sure that.
So k is polylog t. The number of distributions is n choose polylog t or something like that. And if you allow running time polynomial in this, you can check whatever you want. Okay, so that's the result about PCP. That's it. Thank you.
So just to clarify this result about no signaling provers equaling next, or sorry, X. So there was just one round of communication with the provers, is that correct?
Yes.
And okay, it's and the number of provers was polylog T, so.
Yes.
So polylog, so how many provers do you need to get X, I guess, is the question.
A polynomial number of
polynomial,
provers.
Okay.
Polynomial,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay,
you don't know how to do it with smaller number of provers. It cannot be done with two provers.
Yeah,
because
that's
with two provers, it's p-space.
So somewhere between two and polynomial is the
yes,
cut
it's the right answer. Just for our cryptographical result, we don't need a polynomial number of provers. It's perfect. It's perfectly fine for us. So we don't need that. But anyway, we don't know how to do it with less provers.
Thanks.
Yes. Can you explain the intuition why the security against non-signaling provers was related to the security proof of the usage of homomorphic encryption kind of technique that?
Okay. So in the so what happened there is that. The verifier, the prover got Q and R encrypted.
Yes.
And the proof of security more or less says that if, so now suppose that there is a prover that breaks this scheme. So the prover gets Q encrypted and R encrypted and gives A and B encrypted. So the point is that since, okay, so I'm not sure if I said that, but Q and R are encrypted with different keys. So if the prover actually breaks the scheme, then if you know one of the keys, you can know Q, and then you get information between R and the output. So it's not that hard. I have it on two slides, but I removed them. It takes 2 minutes, maybe I'll move it after.
Is it possible that you briefly tell us the relation between how you went from MIP non-signaling to non-signaling PCP? What was the transition?
So this is actually not that hard. Oh, this is this is actually not that hard. You just define, so if you have a multiprover interactive proofs, you just define this distribution. So you think of each query to the PCP as a query to one of the provers, but you do like a symmetrization over all the possibilities for sending it to the provers. So the number of provers should be k, and you ask this to one prover, this to another, this to another, but you do a random permutation between the provers. And then if you have a strategy for the provers, you can define a strategy for the PCP. So we prove soundness against no signaling PCPs, and now we want to prove that there is soundness for no signaling provers. So if we assume for a contradiction that there is no signaling strategies for the prover, we want to define no signaling strategy for the PCP, and you do it just by symmetrization, just by taking these two random provers, a random permutation of the provers.
More questions? Then, thanks again.